Welcome, friends, to the Enduring Gifts of Marvin Gaye podcast, brought to you by your 26-year listening veteran, Jessica. Join me as we celebrate these enduring gifts, the songs of Marvin Gaye. In each episode, I will share insights about the music and recount life experiences tied to it. I'm hoping to inspire you to take a first or your 500 first listen to these songs that are truly the enduring gifts of Marvin Gaye.
All right. This project is like so overwhelmingly kind of important to me, and it's also the final episode that I plan on doing for this podcast series. I'm struggling to kind of gather my thoughts, like, let's just go and let's just go with this. I've recorded several versions of this so far. No, actually, probably about close to almost a month ago now. I probably recorded close to 4 hours worth of content. And let me just reflect on a lot of what that content was focusing on was kind of Marvin Gaye's journey to the time frame just in his overall career of getting to the project Trouble Man. And I feel like that is integral, especially if we're wrapping up this podcast series, to just kind of refresh on Marvin Gaye's career and his journey through his career to be able to be at a place to do a project like Trouble Man. I guess like that's a perfect introduction here to cover kind of this backstory, right? Like the history, the journey up to. And so let's just refresh on that, because we've discussed a lot of it, but like, let's just go a little bit deeper and just kind of rehash some things and just make sure we're understanding where we have come through with Marvin's career to get to this place. So a big element of things, associated with Marvin's career and kind of how it played out is this gossipy thing that we could focus on about the fact that he had married Anna, right? And right, evidently, like what that was supposed to have achieved for him as an advantage, but that I want you to demonstrate to me what that advantage was, because what I can see is the advantage that it wasn't. And so here's one little small possibility of an advantage that I could see that it may have been for Marvin. In his own words, in interviews, talking about himself at Motown during the 1960s, he describes himself as possibly being a little spoiled and maybe even kind of like difficult to work with or whatever. And he would go even more specific to say it's in line with kind of how he would point things out to peers. Oh, you guys have to do things like that. I don't have to do things like that. But honestly, like for me, hearing Marvin Gaye say something like that about himself, the thing about that that resonates to me is that that is Marvin Gaye's spirit. Okay. Like that's the spirit of Marvin Gaye not conforming and not being told what the fuck he would do and not doing it. Okay. And so like, what do we know those types of things are? It's go into that little charm school thing, right? Like he didn't do that. Like you guys do that. I don't do that. And I feel like him saying that though is based on his spirit, right? Like he's just not going to do that. He didn't need to do that. He wasn't going to do that. He didn't do it. The slight advantage that possibly could have been afforded him based on the fact of being married to Anna is that his ass didn't just flat out get fired for that shit. But it kind of goes to a principle as well. It's like certain things that don't happen in your career sometimes, right? In your career sometimes, like times that you don't quit a job sometimes, isn't necessarily the best thing. I think like kind of through the journey through life, I think like your mindset as you become a grown ass adult age wise, like I am by now, I think like by your 40s, people, you're needing to kind of be stepped up a bit in your concepts, your thinking on things. And kind of, I think, like, really by the time you get to this place in life, you're starting to look at that kind of, like, the summation of your life, like, deathbed, looking back, what are the things that you're going to be able to know that your life consisted of? And you'll, let's go to career, sometimes you're going to be able to see that times you didn't necessarily leave a job, was that the best thing for you? Was that the best move that you made? Was that the best decision that you made? Because, okay, deathbed, did you retire from that motherfucker? No, right? So did you put a little bit more time into something than it was really beneficial for you? Kind of satisfying your soul, right? I think, like, once we get to the age range that I'm in now, it's like satisfying the soul is where we need to be trying to elevate, getting things in alignment, right? Like, let's have the things that are in place in our life in alignment with the things that are soul satisfying. And so necessarily for Marvin Gaye, you know, if the advantage that he had to not get fired from Motown for not going to the charm school and shit like that, was that the way that everything played out? Was that necessarily an advantage? You know what I mean? I'm not saying that, because here's maybe the only reason why I can even hint at something like that is because here's a guarantee. Should at any point in time in the 60s, Marvin Gaye had decided to leave Motown for another record label, I have a pretty strong feeling that we could have still been hearing from him. I don't think that necessarily Marvin Gaye would have been a statistic. I don't, you know, like some other artists that left Motown during that time frame and didn't necessarily we hear from them again in the same capacity that we were hearing from them at Motown. Just something kind of sneakingly gives me that suspicion. But at the exact same time, you know what I mean? I do feel like it could have been a roll of the dice for Marvin had he decided to make a move like that with his career. You know, I just think like the music industry was not necessarily as open for artists of color during that time. Like, that's a fact, right? So, you know, I guess I'm kind of maybe looking at that from a lens of nowadays, and I'm like, oh, there'd be no problem for Marvin to have just, you know, kind of picked and choose where he wanted to work. But maybe it wasn't such, you know, many pickings back in those days. So he, you know, I feel like a lot of the fact that Marvin remained at Motown for as long as he did involved a lot of Marvin picking and choosing battles. You know what I mean? So I just think like that's really kind of an essence of his career, substance of it, kind of joy of it during that time frame for himself at Motown then. And so another possible advantage that can be speculated that Marvin had at Motown, kind of like things that didn't get to happen for others, is those jazz projects that he got to release. And so something that I just Googled gave me exactly what I want to tell you about that. So hold on. Jazz, right? I'm talking to you about those jazz projects, right? Because Marvin's like the artist on the Motown roster that has full jazz albums released on him. And it's like, how does that fit into their catalog, right? But how that's not even necessarily an advantage. And I don't know that I've gone this in depth on this with you guys. I'm pretty sure I haven't so far throughout this podcast. Hold on. Let me just Google again what I did and then I'll hit you back. Right. So we could go so far as to say, oh, okay, Marvin was married to Anna, so he could get away with whatever he wanted. He can make whatever music he wanted. And he got to make those jazz records, those jazz albums, possibly. But here's where I don't even think that we can say that. It has come to my attention throughout the course of this, looking up things, that jazz was very much Berry Gordy's MO as well. And then he didn't, you know, necessarily disperse that widely throughout, you know, like making everybody on the roster have a song in their catalog like that. But it was kind of principally, ultimate. I was trying to combine two words, principally and ultimately. Principally and ultimately, a kind of a goal and a prestige and an achievement, and, you know, that he was trying to accomplish in his pursuit. You watch that documentary. Was it on Showtime? It was like the end of 2019. Some cable network did a 2-hour-long documentary on the history of Motown, right? And Berry Gordy's in it. And Berry Gordy and Smokey Robinson. And you talk to the two of them in that movie. And you're asking them, like, what was their motivation in those years? Definitely the beginning of the game, the 60s. Two things. Making money, getting women. Like, y'all were two n***s, right? Like, that is just straight up two n***s. And they were running the game. So, secondary, you know, kind of additionally, definitely kind of breaking through and getting the prestige of being recognized as capable of handling jazz as well, was on his radar, and Gordy's radar. And so guaranteed those Marvin Gaye jazz projects would not have been released had that not been a part of his MO, a part of this vision that he had for what he was trying to achieve with Motown. And so right now I had just Googled which Motown artists performed at the Copacabana. I'm going to pause for a second and I'm going to just give you a better reference of the level of prestige that the Copacabana was all about. Number one, I've told you many times, right? Old movie aficionado, right? So there's a whole movie on my little YouTube channel. They have taken down my little YouTube movie channel so many times. So by now, my YouTube movie channel is named Cinema Classics. It's up and running. Again, we'll see for how long. My sister did actually give me a little tip on something that I will try the next go around if I have to, about just making sure that I identify the fair use protections. And I'm going to point that out for this episode too. Like, I'm going to be citing fair use for the fact that I will be including music in this episode, because it will most definitely be necessary for the educational elements of what I am trying to communicate through this episode. So anyway, Copacabana and its prestige level. There's a whole entire movie that I have on my old movie channel right now. It's called The Joker is Wild, and it stars Frank Sinatra from 1957. And it's about this guy, Joe E. Lewis, from the 1920s that was a singer, jazz singer, and he does a stint at the Copacabana. And I don't know if they may have actually been recording this inside of the Copacabana, but the Copacabana was like the mecca of a place to perform for jazz artists. Period. White artists, everybody jazz artists, like the Copacabana, you're a bad motherfucker if you can get into performing at the Copacabana. It's just extremely prestigious. It's in Hollywood movies during that time frame. So I'm telling you, jazz is also a part of Gordy's MO for what his vision and what he's trying to achieve with Motown. So the fact that Marvin Gaye has 4 full jazz albums released is not so much an advantage that Marvin Gaye has for being married to Anna Gordy, versus those projects would not have even been released if it wasn't a part of Gordy's MO, his ultimate vision and what he's trying to achieve. A way that you can correlate this: Tiger Woods dominating golf. Okay? Exact concept, a black and white thing. That's what's going on. It's a goal. It's a prestige level. It's a statement that is being made. It's a thing just in itself, right? So I Google which Motown artist performed at the Copacabana. Here I'm quoting. It's a little paragraph. First thing that pops up, it's coming from Wikipedia. The Supremes We're following Ella Fitzgerald, Lena Horne, Sammy Davis Jr., Sarah Vaughan, Nat King Cole, and Sam Cooke, among the first African-American entertainers to appear at the Copa. And playing the club was seen by Motown CEO Berry Gordy as an inroads into the conservative white middle America market. Now, that last part right there, white middle America market and inroads into it. So there's an interview with Marvin in 1983 kind of talking about that time frame in music for himself as an artist, specifically himself, but definitely his peers in black music during the early 1960s. He's explaining the degree to which, like, white households a lot of the time would refuse to allow their young children, their teenagers or whatever, to be buying records that are made by black artists. Like, that's just how, no, this is, you don't bring it into the home, let alone, and that's your buying public, right? So there's a crossover inability right there, let alone getting the music played on the radio stations, kind of exact same concept, effect, reason right there. So yeah, you know what I mean? You're definitely, as it is, you're trying to make those inroads into the white middle America market to get them to buy your music and to get the music being played on the radio. That's the thing about Motown. That's their legacy. That's what they did. That's why you have in the game today. That's why hip hop exists. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's why kind of the definition of culture nowadays is hip hop, right? Like, that's why it's everybody's cool if they're about hip hop nowadays, right? But where that originally kind of, and the inroads that were first made to just even get any type of crossover appeal into black music, you got to put that on the back of Motown. That's where that comes from. That's where how we in society nowadays, in an episode that I have done on this series where it's like, I had to Google because it's like, when did the Civil Rights Act pass in this country? But probably should know about that. Probably should understand fuck all of that entailed, because it's the reason why you right now, me right now, cannot know when the fuck that happened, right? It's like, that's the reason why society is so structured and set up the way that it is right now, and things are so law and things are so your reality that you don't even need to know when the fuck it became reality or when the fuck there was a time that it wasn't like that. You know what I'm saying? So it's like, literally, and this is very in reference to what this episode will be covering, very specifically, only coming from Marvin Gaye, that I will be talking to you about. Hip hop can be the dominance and like the definition of culture, and it's the coolest thing. And if you're about hip hop, you're a cool motherfucker, you're a bad motherfucker. You could be white, right? But if you're like trying to emulate hip hop culture, you're on track, you're on target, right? You're cool, you got some cred. It's because originally some inroads were made into a white middle America market that allowed that music to be getting played in households. And Marvin very much was, you know, he had to struggle through his music kind of initially being rejected just exactly for the purpose and point that he was black. His music could be struggled to be getting played in certain markets because he was black. You know, and of course that's not his story alone, but he's pointing that out. So to step it up, even, it's like, okay, so you achieve that, right? Because now Motown just becomes the sound of the youth of America, or whatever it was, the young America, or whatever, right? And a way that they achieve that, too, is they start making these little records and their little album packaging and shit, and they don't put pictures of the artists that, wait a minute, Mr. Postman single has just, the artwork on that is just a picture of a mailbox, right? So you don't have to be afraid. You don't have to know necessarily that these are black people singing the song. Just listen to the music. Focus on the music. So you can start to dominate the game in that way. And now, oh, okay, your music can be getting played on these radio stations. There's no barrier to entry anymore. But now let's like up the ante and up our goals and up what we're trying to prestigiously achieve. Let's set our sights on the Copacabana. Well, that's all about jazz, because I can guarantee you ain't necessarily getting up in there just singing Motown sound. They did, and I'm sure that they did. We have the projects to listen. I've never listened, but I'm sure that there was a, and guess what? It was a blend of straight jazz standards, and it was a blend of their Motown hits repackaged into a jazzy sounding sound. Marvin Gaye's album, he has a little Motown hits medley, and it's all jazzed up. So why I'm pointing this out, though, is that it's not an advantage that Marvin had being married to Anna that he got those albums released. It's that kind of second-handedly, because it was all about money and bitches for Gordy and Robinson. Listen to him. They are hilarious the way that they are so serious. That is what they were about, why they were doing their thing in those days. But secondhand, right? And like actually business-wise and shit, they had some goals in mind, and it was like breaking down some barriers. And so Copacabana is major, big time achievement in accomplishing those goals. And so the Supremes perform there in, okay, where did I see this? 1965, I thought, is what they said about the Supremes, because there's another. Yeah, okay, the Supremes at the Copa, 1965. And then who, and their little concerts, because I think what happens, you get into the Copa and you perform over a couple of different nights. And then, you know, maybe the way Motown did that is they record songs from the different nights, they package it together. Here's your little record of the Supremes at the Copa in 1965, right? I don't know that that all happened in one fell swoop in one concert. It may have been songs handpicked from different performances. So they're in there in 65. And then the Temptations do the same thing in 68, and their project gets released. Well, kind of how this is not an advantage for Marvin, but kind of how this would absolutely be a bucket list achievement for Marvin among these three groups, the Supremes, the Temptations, and Marvin Gaye. Who of those artists is all about jazz and kind of ultimately and fundamentally wants to be creating jazzy veined art, right? And so it's not an advantage for Marvin that he has his engagement there in August of 1966 and gets to by himself, right? And that's even more of an accomplishment. He ain't a part of a group. Hold on, I'm just reading this little article because I clicked, it's a Wikipedia here. I feel like in this, they explain that this happens for Marvin as well over a series of nights. So hold on, let me just read this article and then I'm going to come back to you. Well, this is a complete bitch, and it is exactly in line with what everything that I'm telling you already, preambling into, and then just to read some fucking articles. It's like, yeah, this is exactly what the fuck I'm talking to you about how there was no advantage to Marvin Gaye and how I throw out the terminology, fuck Motown. Why I do that is on behalf of Marvin Gaye, because it's like, I can't even say, and I don't mean any disrespect by that. No, it's like, actually I do, because I'm retaliating like to the disrespect that was shown to Marvin Gaye in so many ways at Motown, okay? So already, like I've pointed out, there was no fucking advantage to him through this, oh, he married Anna Gordy, right? Like, if that was the only reason he did that was to get some advantage to his career, well, that absolutely did not happen. He was not ever put into a position of being a vice president there. Others were. He did not get the correct level of royalties, but that's just kind of music industry contracting. But you know what I'm saying? Like him being the brother-in-law of the president, that didn't fucking give him an advantage for that, right? There's just like so many elements or aspects and ways that you could try and say, oh, that would have been an advantage for him, that it wasn't. So when it comes to this fucking Copacabana debacle, when I was just reading the article on Wikipedia, hold on, before I go there, let me read what I'm telling you. I have a suspicion, and I thought I had read it somewhere, that Marvin's project was not just straight recording from one concert. I think I was just saying that about the Supremes, but specifically for Marvin's, it was not. So let me tell you, there has been amazing stuff that I have found over the course of this project. Very rare, and I don't know why I haven't favorited these things so that I can get back to them, but very rarely when I'm just searching for Marvin Gaye on the internet, I will come across these little sites, and I don't know how people have set them up, but it's somebody's personal thing, where they are like just taking the pictures of the liner note packages from different discs. And they're just scanning it, right? They're just scanning the booklet. So that's how, by this point in time, I can't even recall the last time that I actually had to take a trip over to Best Buy to physically purchase a new release of Marvin's in order to be able to have access to it, right? It's like, you don't have to do that anymore. You can hear it on Spotify and find liner notes online. So I've done that several times. And so there was one time in doing that, I came across a site that had the complete booklet from the Copa project scanned in. And so I'm just sitting here reading the booklet, right, without having it in hand. But right now I'm on some site that has a slight little bit of stuff pulled out of that booklet. And so they're saying a producer's note. Marvin Gaye did not do the same Copa show twice. This album represents the best performances from several shows, as if you went to every one. Be sure to tip your waitress and the coat check girl. So this is the debacle about Marvin Gaye's performance at the Copa, right? Because what did we just see? Along the line of greats in jazz that happen to be black musicians, it's a humongous achievement as a black artist to be able to get into the Copa. There was something that I saw a second ago too, where they were just pointing out that like Marvin Gaye was one, they said only one of very few. Where was I just reading this? It was just on the internet. I didn't have to click into a result. But they were saying that he was one of only very few African-American artists following like Sammy Davis Jr. and Sam Cooke that got to play at the Copa, which also included total, I guess, Motown acts that performed there was the Supremes in 65, Marvin in 66, Temptations in 68, and Martha and the Vandellas in 68. But it was like a huge fucking big deal. And like of all, now let's add in the Vandellas, of all of those artists who is completely about jazz, ultimate vision that he has for his career, Marvin Gaye. Well, they point out, and this is what I'm saying, it's a bitch, because all you gotta do, this, it's a very slim article, it's a paragraph on Wikipedia. They're pointing out, and let's just quote it. They're saying that Marvin performed in August of 1966, over a year following the Supreme ballyhooed 1965 performance there. Okay, here it was. Marvin was only one of just a few R&B musicians after Sam Cooke and Jackie Wilson to perform at the club, where performers such as Sammy Davis Jr., Nat King Cole, and Frank Sinatra had performed at regularly. Marvin was the second act from Berry Gordy's fabled Motown label following the Supremes to perform at the nightclub, and would be followed by the Temptations in 68 and Martha and the Vandellas that same year. According to the liner notes later on, Marvin's performance there was a success. However, this is the bitch part of it, and this is what the fuck I'm talking about, not an advantage and fuck Motown. Back to quoting. An ongoing feud between Gaye and his brother-in-law, Motown recording boss Gordy, was said to have been one of the reasons why the album was eventually shelved, with a duo fighting over how the album was to be produced. That is going to be such the segue into the continuation of this conversation, but I'm glad that I'm not the only one that knows this. Okay. So the album had been scheduled for release in January 1967 if he had just recorded it in August of 66. Package it up, get it together, let's have it on the shelves. Tamla 273 release in January of 1967. But it was just permanently shelved. In 2005, Hippo Select Records, a Motown-associated label created to re-release or release unreleased material from Motown's vaults, remastered sessions from this album and released it that year. So hold on one second. Let me look at life. This year is 2021 and I will become 42. In 2005, okay. I was just wondering, there was a song, Night Song, that was my birthday gift from Marvin Gaye through the universe, ethers, to me on my birthday night when I turned 34. And I was just trying to think, in 34, was that year 2005? No. Hold on, right? My birth year is always just 1 year ahead of the year. So no. In 34, hold on one second though. This doesn't seem like it's possible. In 2005, I would have been 36. And so how did I get it when I was 34? I swear I was only 34 though when this happened. But anyway, that's all the more the reason why that came to me from Marvin. But it had to be that far into life from 1966 that we were made aware of the fact. Because this was not even a project on the Marvin Gaye Collection discography pages. Marvin Gaye at the Copa isn't even a little picture of the album cover and the listing of the songs. And ooh, that's an album that Marvin Gaye recorded, but they just haven't released it on disc yet. No, bitch, you didn't even get to have an inkling of the fact that because your ass is born a decade plus after 1966, so why the fuck would you know that he had recorded anything at the Copacabana, right? Like, you just wouldn't know that unless you had bothered to be able to buy a ticket to go see him perform in person at the Copacabana in August of 1966 over a few nights. Like, unless that is what got to happen in your life, you probably had no fucking idea that he recorded that concert. Why am I talking about this right now? It's the backstory into how we get to Trouble Man. It's wrapping up this podcast, so we're just going to touch on things that haven't been touched on. But that's a big part of the experience of Marvin Gaye being in Motown, especially during that decade of the 60s. Our man is working and making songs and recording music. A lot of that shit goes straight into a vault. And there seems to have been a reason for that, right? So when I say fuck Motown, yeah, all of the disrespect associated with that is intended. Because I'm speaking on behalf of Marvin Gaye and his career, and I guarantee you a bucket list achievement of himself being able to be on a list of high-level, legendary African-American performers that got an opportunity to get into that club, which is equivalent to Tiger Woods dominating golf for the time that he did. You know what I mean? It's just, it's a thing in itself. It's an accomplishment in itself just for that thing. And his project to go straight into a vault on that, fuck Motown. And oh, get the project, people. Dial into that on Spotify. Listen to Night Song. And all the more doubled middles to Motown. So, I mean, the mental pressure, I'm breathing in that right now. You know what I'm saying? Like, the in and out of my ability to breathe, it's infected a little bit with the mental pressure that as an artist you would be living with. Being someplace where your career is being handled like that.
when that's what you're about, that music that you were able to do over those three, I do believe again that it's three nights that he was there, and they were there in their, with their recording equipment, capturing that. And it doesn't get to get released. For why? For some bullshit? For some egos? And how do you have an advantage when the end result is that your shit doesn't get to be released? Like, being the brother-in-law of the head of that shit, there's no advantage. The advantage doesn't exist. But that's like the vein of music that you're trying to present to people, right? That's what we've come to understand, people. That's what he was about. That's what he was trying to share and show. There's 17 songs. The last is a Motown medley. Motown medley 2. He must have, okay, he does a Motown medley pretty early on into what they've provided here. But there's 17 songs. That's pretty fucked up. So, you know, there's a lot of statistics around Marvin Gaye during that time frame. It's coming from Berry Gordy. It's really coming from Berry Gordy that I'm referring to. Here's something very interesting to see if I have saved onto the Marvin Gaye channel. I've got so many playlists. For myself, no. I was just going to say, like, where I have to scroll to, but I know it may look different for me being the creator of the channel than for you guys. Usually when I get in just to my playlists on that Marvin Gaye channel, like, I have to go all the way down to the bottom to see it. But right now it's just moved quite a ways up. So I have a playlist called Marvin Gaye. Let me make sure I've got this muted. Marvin Gaye Rare TV Performances. Let's see. And I don't know if I have saved into here this time that Berry Gordy was on this little, like, Teen USA. I've referenced this to you guys. Teen USA. No, I don't have it on this list. Show in the early 1960s. It's black and white. It's before Marvin has even recorded I Heard It Through the Grapevine. And so Berry Gordy it seems to be this little show that comes on the weekends. And they have a little live studio audience, and it's a whole bunch of teenagers. And this show seems to be going into the headquarters of different recording labels, and they're just taking their cameras in and their day in the life, you know, they're following people around. And so that footage from that show, you've seen several other places since then. You know, it's just black and white footage of the different Motown artists in the studio. You see the Supremes. I think you see Berry Gordy talking to Smokey Robinson. And so anyway, it was on this little show. Towards the end of it, Berry Gordy is pointing out that there's a number of Motown artists that had not come with him that day to be performing on the show, because in between the host sitting there with Berry Gordy and then they're looking at the footage, different Motown artists are getting up and performing live on the show too. And so at the end of it, Berry wants to point out, you know, oh, let's don't forget a lot of our other artists that aren't here right now with us today. And he points out, for instance, Marvin Gaye, who, and then here's the statistic that I say I hear, and it's coming from Berry. I wish I had this right now so that I could exactly tell you what he said. But it's something to the effect of, like, Marvin Gaye is our single most consistent charting artist, like high record sales artist, our single most consistent. Okay. And that's early on. And then, though, Marvin will also have I Heard It Through the Grapevine, which, let me just Google that really quick, because, like I said, there's a statistic on that, too, where supposedly, you know, it's like the highest selling song on the Motown label of all time. But let me just confirm exactly what the statistic is there.
Okay, well, I've just spent a lot of time looking this up. I couldn't find it before where I found it. It was just a hit. I don't even know, like, what I had search that out for. I feel like in some type of a documentary I had seen that, and then on the internet it was just a boom result. So right now I had Googled like highest selling Motown song of all time. Okay, I feel like that was the Google, and the result again, not an article, not a link to click, just boom, Google answers the question, was Let's Get It On by Marvin Gaye. Oops. Oh, okay. But then, now I was on the top 10 biggest Motown hits of all time. Okay, there's some little page that you can click on. And number one is, I heard it through the grapevine. What's my Google? Highest selling Motown song of all time into Google. Result, Let's Get It On. People, I have such a pride in knowing that you ride for the baddest motherfucker of all time. Like, you were already doing that. Like, you were just doing it so hard. But then it's just like, wow. You know? Yeah, there's such a pride in that. But I haven't digressed because, wow. Wow. Yeah, but why were we on that? Because we were just factualizing Marvin Gaye's prowess and his standing among his peers there at Motown, okay? Though his career is really being fucked around with a lot during those years as well. Even just to get fucking to, I heard it through the grapevine, there's just all of this backstory to it, right? It's, oh, it was recorded first by Smokey Robinson, and then it was the Isley Brothers took a stab at it, and it just keeps on, nope, not good enough to be released. And so then it gets over to Marvin, and still, nope, not good enough to be released. And then it goes over to Gladys Knight and the Pips, and they finally release that. And then that happens. And then they revisit, you know, Marvin's version. Because what did I feel like? Oh, my gosh. Gordy made the decision that, like, when it came to the next single that was going to be released on Marvin, Gordy chooses a song called Your Unchanging Love. Oh my goodness. Ooh, ooh. That's a little bit of a tough one to listen to. I feel like that song was written by Stevie Wonder. It's, ooh. I mean, that's, yeah, that probably is, it gets a skip. Okay. But it was Gordy's decision on what was to come next for Marvin. And he chose to release Your Unchanging Love instead of I Heard It Through the Grapevine on Marvin at a point in time. Because they go ahead and at a point they include I Heard It Through the Grapevine on an album that Marvin had coming out that year called In the Groove. Now, when I purchased that disc, wow, that disc is not in my cases. But I do remember getting that disc from Best Buy early on in the experience. And it was called In the Groove on the album work, I'm pretty sure. Oh, Corona, you better have this disc. Ah, I better just fucking have this, people. Oh, look, there's Trouble Man. A version of it. I'm pretty fucking sure that I don't have that in a case. And I don't see it chilling in here either. But I know I made the purchase because I remember the disc, and like that's the album that I'm hearing. There goes my baby, moving on down the line, walking around, wonder where she is bound. I broke her heart and I made her cry. Now I'm alone, so all alone. Well, anyway. Eek, ole. That's not nice. I don't like that. I don't like not being able to find my inventory. Well, anyway, I know that I bought that disc at a point in time. And it was called In the Groove. And I heard it through the grapevine is included on that. And, you know, then that hit takes off so hard that they rename
same artwork and shit, but they just rename, you know, the title of the disc over to I Heard It Through the Grapevine. So, just looking in the cases here. Just hold on. You got to bear with me 1 second. You know, I can't really handle. Okay.
Now, see, I confused myself. Because, actually, I was... Okay. What I have... Okay. I found it. Life is okay. That's a way to fuck with me. Like, hard.
It is in the disc case. It's in disc case number 2. And it is Marvin Gaye, I Heard It Through the Grapevine.
Okay, I thought I had it packaged as In the Groove.
Let me see. Let me open this, though, and see if
somewhere it actually does appear. Is that... No. That's really weird. You open this up, and they have a picture of the cover of I Want You. What the fuck is really going on with that? Wow. Marvin Gaye, I Heard It Through the Grapevine. Open it up. Just a flip open. It's just a little page here. It's got the track listing. And then picture of I Want You. Yep, the last song on there. There Goes My Baby. Let's see here. You, Tear It On Down, Chained, I Heard It Through the Grapevine. At Last I Found a Love. Some Kind of Wonderful. Loving You is Sweeter, Change What You Can, It's Love I Need, Every Now and Then, You're What's Happening in the World Today, There Goes My Baby. I was wondering if Your Unchanging Love is on this project. Now, Your Unchanging Love is on The Moods of Marvin Gaye, which is released in either 65 or 66. Let's see, that's in here too. That's interesting, because that's years. And... what I was just reading is it said that Gordy made the decision to release as the next single on Marvin, Your Unchanging Love, which is written... Hold on, let me see what this is. Oh, okay. It's a Brian Holland, Lamont Dozier, Edward Holland written song. And produced by them. You're the One for Me is the one that's written by Stevie Wonder. I thought that there were two songs written by Stevie Wonder on this album for Marvin. Hold on. Ain't That Peculiar Nightlife? You've Been a Long Time Coming. You're in Changing Love. Okay. Definitely You're the One for Me is the one that's a skippable one. You're in Changing Love is not really ringing a bell for me then, if I have that confused. But yeah, hold on. Let me see. This album is released in... 1966, and Gordy is choosing between I Heard It Through the Grapevine and Your Unchanging Love. So, like, that's, again, an example. It is their highest selling song of all time, people. And this motherfucker had it sit in the vault from 66 until 68 when the, you know, Gordy? I'm just, you know, by this episode in this series, didn't have the best ear, did he? Not all the time, you know? A lot of things that were accomplished. But I'm not sure that I can give him dap. I'm having the best ear, so... let's further explore why I say that. Let's just keep it moving, shall we? Into how I was explaining on the paragraph write-up for Marvin Gaye at the Copacabana. And how, why we're focusing on that project is to prove the point that Marvin did not necessarily have an advantage for marrying Anna at Motown. And the fact that he had those 4 standalone jazz projects released in his career ultimately didn't really have shit to do with, oh, Marvin's the Prince of Motown and he can do whatever the fuck he wants. No, there's this kind of underlying MO level of prestige and achievement breaking through, making inroads into middle white America market that Gordy is trying to achieve. And definitely getting his artists to be able to appear at Copacabana
is a crossover appeal effect that he's trying to achieve. Yet, when it comes to his single most consistent charting artist, Marvin Gaye, who had an opportunity to represent his organization there, based on some fucking ego and bullshit and games, the whole entire project goes straight into the vault. Because why did the article say? More water. They were bumping heads on how it was to be produced, right? So that's extra fucked, right? Because we had knowledge that there had been a set release date established for that. Now that's, I'm telling you how fucked that is, people. In this shit that I do right now, my goodness, I have not ever yet experienced that we are moving all the fuck the way ahead with a project with a deadline date and we're making progress on it. We're needing to do this. We're needing to get the work done. And then just at the last minute, oh, the entity that's requesting the work just decides, fuck it, we ain't accepting nothing from nobody. That's fucked up. And I'd be super fucking pissed if we had ever experienced something like that. All the work that you're putting into creating something for a deadline and then just, oh, fuck it. You know? That's games. And that is fucking with your career. So, and why did it seem to be that was the move that was made is because of some kind of punishment for Marvin, ego for Marvin. Here's one weird, really, really, really weird little statement that Gladys Knight made in reference to Marvin Gaye one time during this time frame. And I was like, Gladys, who the fuck knows what the fuck you are talking about? Gladys Knight herself is getting interviewed on some tape recorded television recorded interview. Some black British lady is interviewing her. And she's just talking about her own career. And it's, I don't even remember if the interviewer brought up Marvin Gaye, but now somehow, maybe. Right? Because why would they, what were we just talking about? Heard it through the grapevine, right? Like that's what Gladys Knight and Marvin Gaye have in common. And I probably do believe that, because you know what, just to say, Gladys Knight is a little, yeah. So she was bringing it up along those lines, you know, just throwing a little salt and shade on Marvin about the fact that his version of that song did better than hers, but she's just definitely trying to point out that they did it first, released it first. And deeper than that, somehow she keeps on talking about Marvin Gaye. And because, and you could tell, like, the interviewer, by the time that Gladys made this little statement that she made, the interviewer wasn't really trying to talk about Marvin Gaye. She was interviewing Gladys Knight. So Gladys made this little statement that, like, I'm going to say, Gladys, who the fuck knows what the fuck you were talking about? And the interviewer was just kind of like, yeah, uh-huh, and kept it moving because she was trying to talk to Gladys Knight about herself. I'm going to see if I can find, yeah, let's see Gladys Knight. This was some really random little interview that I was, I don't know why the fuck I watched this either. It was pretty lengthy. She was talking about how she had a problem with gambling and shit. Like, it was very in-depth. But anyway, so in addition, as Gladys is just kind of continuing to be a little gossipy, she points out how, you know, it was so sad when Motown exiled Marvin over to Europe like that. And that's what I'm saying, like, who the fuck knows what she is talking about? And so the interviewer was like, yeah, uh-huh. And she just kept it moving. Like, she did not at all ask Gladys to explain what the fuck she was talking about, but kept it moving. But it games and kind of fucking up a career. And evidently, I have no idea what the backstory or additional information is on that. But Gladys Knight said it was just a shame and so sad, and kind of how they fucked Marvin over, how they exiled him over into Europe that time. It's just like, what? I don't, what are you talking about? But yeah, I think she thought that this was like a common knowledge thing that she just threw out there. And the interviewer played like she knew what she was talking about, but wanted to keep it moving. So, you know, it's just, yeah, just kind of a fucking with one's career that it seemed like Marvin really just kind of had to deal with during that time, and kind of bumping heads a bit with Gordy more than an advantage being just the summation of his experience. Okay. So by the time that we progress from the end of that decade, right, into the beginning of the next, things have changed for Marvin. You know, what has happened is Marvin has received, you know, like the end of his abilities to deal with the bullshit. Okay. He's in the corner now and he's done and he's going to come out swinging. So this thing is about to stop recording. Let me end this segment and we'll start another. Okay, so what I was thinking about is like where Marvin is now. Okay, that's been the experience of a decade. But the experience of a decade translates into what? Kind of even if you suck. New titleization that gets to be associated with your name. Expert. Okay? So now we're getting into the territory where among this kind of being the overarching experience, rocking it at Motown, Marvin Gaye has also evolved into being an expert in the game. And what is the game? What is it, something that even Berry Gordy does have the ability to give to Marvin, is that he's like the purest artist that he's ever known. So Marvin's game is art. And now, hold on. I don't know if this is it, but it says Gladys Knight UK TV interview. Just hold on one second if I can see if this is in here. Yes. Okay, I found this. People, this is buried. It's got 1.8K views, 1,800 views, and it's from dated 2 years ago. It's the title of it is Mika Paris Meets Gladys Knight Part 2. Somehow, randomly in the course of doing this podcast, this little interview popped up. It's 23 minutes, and I'm listening to it. And it actually is just audio only. There's a picture of him in audio only. But and this lady, she is from the UK. She flew over to South Carolina to interview Gladys Knight. So it's the very beginning. I've got this paused at 6 minutes into this little interview, but they've been spending probably the past 3 minutes talking about the fact that both of them recorded the same song on the same label. Somewhere else I heard this. I heard it from Marvin's perspective, pretty much, right? About how it's kind of unethical to do that to artists. Right? To like make different artists record the same song on the same, you know, recording label. I remember that being Marvin's kind of take on the fact that they both recorded that song. But yeah, so, and then there's various, nobody really seems to know the true history of, I heard it through the grapevine, because as I'm saying that right now, I am recalling in that documentary on Motown with Berry Gordy and Smokey Robinson talking about it, how the main theme that they were trying to achieve was getting money and bitches. There is a part towards the end of that documentary where this subject of I Heard It Through the Grapevine comes up, and the two of them are going back and forth, neither one being able to confirm who, what, how, where, when did I Heard It Through the Grapevine come into existence, and who recorded it first, and who passed on it, and who got assigned to it, and all of this shit. So really, I don't know if anybody really knows the story, but I do remember in that documentary too, they both like are ready to bet on it. They do. They make a bet for like 500. They're like, they just have the cash in their pocket, right? Like 500, let's go. They put the money down. And I feel like somehow an assistant or somebody steps away, goes and looks up some stuff in their Motown records and comes back and had an actual, and Smokey lost the bet. But even Barry wasn't completely correct on everything that he had been stating. I feel like Barry got corrected on something too, but he was more correct than Smokey had been about whatever the fuck they were talking about that song.
So anyway, you know, Marvin being associated with it as well, I feel like he was saying that he kind of felt it was unethical, just period, that it's even something to discuss, or that Gladys Knight and himself have versions of the exact same song. So anyway, in this interview with Gladys Knight, she's talking about how, because that lady was asking her, like, how do you feel about the fact that, you know, Marvin Gaye had so much success on that song? And she's like, the only reason why she felt a little bit of a way about it was just personally for Gladys Knight and the Pips. She's like, we worked so hard to have a hit on that label. And so it was just that. It was like, that was kind of the slap in the face. But she was like, it was because it was Marvin, we were very happy for him. And then that's when she says, because, you know, Marvin was banished over to Europe and he couldn't even come back to record anything. And then she explains, and you know that we toured over in Europe often. So when we saw him over there, he was just so happy to see somebody from home. And she was like, so as much of our free time as we could, she's like, we gave it to Marvin. And then this lady, she's like, oh, I know, because he was just going through hell, wasn't he? And she's like, yep, he sure was, you know, and so that's the reason why as much of our free time as we could give to him, we did. And then she's like, and so then, hold on, let me listen to this again so that I can correctly say this. Marvin had been banished to Europe. He couldn't even come here to record or do nothing like that. And we played Europe quite a bit, as you know, and we were very good friends. And he was so happy to see somebody from home, and we hung out all the free time that we could give to him. We gave it to him. And so when he came back and he got this hit, which he deserved, and then here goes the interview. Oh, because he was just going through hell, huh? And Gladys Knight repeats, she's like, oh, he was going through hell. And that's the reason why he came back and did the music that he did. And then this is very curious. It's just, God don't like ugly. And now you know that when she makes that statement, she's referring to what was being done to Marvin. God doesn't like ugly. And then he came back and he did his thing. What's going on? Okay, that's the segue of my life that I needed to now get us into how Marvin is now at the place in his career of being at the art of what's going on, which let's just recap because this is hour two now, right? And what did I say in the very beginning? Why we are kind of starting with definitely the backstory, but even why we really need to start with what's going on to get into the project of Trouble Man is because in the games that Motown plays of re-releasing and re-releasing and repackaging and re-releasing again and again, the exact same project over and over again. Actually, hold on. When I was looking for that disc, right? And I said, oh, here's Trouble Man. Well, it's a version of Trouble Man. So let me pull it out and see if I can need to refer to it. But anyway, right? So, and that's even as fan number one, I don't have time to buy like 50 copies of the exact same fucking project over and over again. So yeah, I don't have a hard copy of the 40th anniversary release of Trouble Man, and I also don't have a copy of the 40th anniversary release of What's Going On. However, as I pointed out, if you're going to bother to put your money down on anything, do it on those versions of those projects, because Motown has come up off of really a lot of the goods. How do we know if it's all of it, though? So let me see what this is. This version of Trouble Man. Is what was included. Oh, there is some write-up in here too, but I know who it's... Oh, it's not. It's by somebody named Stephen Ivory. I can read this. I will read that too. I totally... Ah, see, just as I'm talking to you guys, I came across the fact that I have... This is like candy for me right now. I didn't even remember that I had a different little packaging here of Trouble Man. See, as I am sitting down right now, I have another booklet of Trouble Man right here. So, you know, I have two versions of this shit. I didn't really feel the need to go get another, but again, as mentioned, that is really the version that would be worth your time. So anyway, I will get into that later. We were talking about the fact that we are approaching the what's going on time frame with Marvin's career.
And how we start with what's going on to get into Trouble Man, because in this unreleased material at the 40th anniversary interval, there is a song that Marvin is working on in the recording sessions for What's Going On that morphs into basically kind of, kind of almost like the core theme for the Trouble Man project. When I'm saying that to you right now, like I'm off in my mind's eye into a good segment and portion of the film Trouble Man, which, like I pointed out somewhere before recently, you know, I've been doing a lot of research for that, and including down to watching the movie. And I'm going to give you the minute and second points in the movie where these different songs play in the movie. And so there is a good segment toward the end of the movie. It's like the climax of the movie. It's when Trouble Man is just kicking ass. Like, that is an interesting movie. It's just right now, just to think on that. It's like, what is his history? Who was Trouble Man really? He was like a Green Beret or something, or like a Navy SEAL. Like, they don't point this out, but like, there's no way that he achieves what he achieves in that movie without having been some type of a special ops military background man prior to him just being Trouble Man and doing what he's doing right now out of a war. But he has like this tactical military like experience that he is just, there is a good segment of this movie, and it is kind of towards the end, and it's kind of the climax of the movie, but Marvin's music is just popping off, giving you the life of what you are visually seeing him doing. And that sound is this morphorization of this song that we hear that he is working on while he's making What's Going On. Okay, so that's his art, right? And this is 71-ish. And where Marvin has evolved to when it comes to his art, which he is an artist, so that is his thing, that's what he is about, is he's become an expert at it. But when we have to just think on that too, it's like you and I have not necessarily been exposed to that yet at that point in his career. Now, were I alive by 71, I'm already fan number one, okay, on the planet. And I'm already writing hardcore with Marvin. He is already the baddest motherfucker that there ever is. That's established. These are facts. And that's what's going on. But even at that, even though that's how hard I understand it and I get it and I know and I can't wait for more and all of this, what my experience as a fan of Marvin Gaye has not necessarily consisted of yet is receiving fully unadulterated Marvin Gaye's art. And in our last episode, we cover what that means. It's two words. It's Marvin Gaye. Because the floodgates are getting ready to open here, because Marvin is not backing the fuck down with these motherfuckers, Motown, okay? He's coming out swinging. And the fact that he does that is the reason why we receive his art for the first time. It's the reason that we get Marvin Gaye for the first time. Because obviously what has to be happening in the 1971-ish timeframe, because what happens, Motown releases What's Going On in May of 71, right? Because a year later, in 72, in D.C., like commemorating the one-year anniversary of the release of the project, they're having Marvin Gaye Day, and that's in May sometime. So album gets released in May of 71. And actually, hold on one second. Just turned off a light, but let me turn it back on, and the Marvin Gaye booklet is right here. Let's just confirm this. Let's get some good information here. So Marvin Gaye collection, get to the discography here. Let's get to What's Going On is released May of 1971. That's all it says. It doesn't give me a day, but it's May of 1971. So ish, we're talking about 71 time frame, because let's back out from here. Let's just keep backing out so that we can get to the ishness of the time frame. What do we know? Okay, after Marvin has to come out swinging. And what is it? Let's just maybe even start right there. What does he have to come out swinging about? Obviously, we're starting to see a pattern, right? Is going on between Marvin and Barry. Kind of just those two, right? Like, I can't even, that's the reason why when I came back to you after I had just read the paragraph on the Copacabana project and how I said, oh, this is a bitch. Because I didn't even need to get the information that I swear, like, just on Barry Gordy, I didn't even need to get the information that I got. I thought the fucking reason that project did not get released, because I was already sitting here like, well, what the fuck? Why didn't Marvin's get released? And that's disrespect on Marvin. And that was Marvin's like bucket list achievement, to be able to just be in the fucking Copa. And he had an album that was recorded on it. And why the fuck wasn't it released? And then I'm just going to read this little Wikipedia article to get some information about how many performances did he do that created that project. That's what I was trying to get for you. That's all I was trying to get for you. I didn't need to really get the gist of all of that, is that, oh, it just didn't get released because it was a bump in heads of the ego between those two. And it had gotten to the place that it had had a release date assigned to it on Tamla, whatever number. So that's like a slot on the assembly line to press shit out, right? Like, has a cover already been drafted up? See, now that would be getting up into the work that I'm doing. That's where you're like fucking with my work too. That's what I'm saying. Like, I wish, I don't wish it, but it's like, you would not want to see my reaction to how pissed off I would be. Was I working on some shit like that? Like, would that ever happen to me in my career right now, where we get together and we are creating our project and it has a deadline for when it needs to be turned in, and just because somebody's being an asshole, oh, fuck the deadline, it's not happening now. But you just did all your work. Because you know that, like, to get a deadline assigned and work is beginning, well, work is being done and people's time is getting wasted if we just fuck the deadline. No, it's not going to happen. Because I say so. You know, at the bottom line is the reason why that shit's happening. Playing the games of I can say so it doesn't get to happen. What is the Marvin having to come out swinging story of what's going on? Ish in 71, right? It's that in order for Gordy to be seemingly being himself, and I'm showing some respect to say that, to flat the fuck out be wanting to refuse to release what's going on, I do really believe that at the point he is digging his heels in on that, the material that he's been exposed to is literally the song What's Going On. And I believe that it was just a refusal to release it as a single. What did we just discover in trying to determine factually what's the deal with I Heard It Through the Grapevine? It's the number one selling song of all time of Motown. But again, something I wasn't trying to get at but got is that when it came to Gordy, he had in front of him the option of I Heard It Through the Grapevine or Your Unchanging Love. You know, hold the fuck on 1 second. Let me hear what the fuck this song is. Because like I said, I was telling you, it hurts. You could skip it. But I confused it with the one that was written by Stevie Wonder. Let me just listen to Your Unchanging Love for just a quick second. Just a quick little point here. I wanna hold on, hold on, hold on, hold on. To your unchanging love, I need you, baby. Yes, I need you right now. That or
I heard it through the grapevine. So, I'm not so convinced of the strength of Cordy's ear. Because, further, what he had to for sure have been presented with was a draft of the song What's Going On. And his response to it is he digs his heels in to refuse to release. Now, you know, here we go. So that's it. That's the straw that breaks Marvin's back, right? That he's a decade into the game now of his art. He's a prolific songwriter by admission in 76 to Paul Gambaccini. I think he's really referring to himself in that decade of the 60s. What do we know? There was a time frame during the decade of the 60s that Sammy Davis Jr., who we saw was among the few prestigious African-American performers able to perform at the Copacabana, was in talks. This comes out in that Paul Gambaccini interview in 76. To sign up with Motown. I don't know, like, all the way as a full-on Motown artist, or just to do an album, or just to do a song or something, but that's in the works. And Marvin hears of that, and he wants to write a song for Sammy to record, and he does. And he presents it and says, hey, this happens, can he record this song? So he's a songwriter, right? Like, he is writing songs. He's a songwriter. If this world were mine. Yeah. So he explains he's a prolific songwriter. And there's like a piano bench full of songs that nobody will ever be able to hear because he wasn't just going to be giving away his shit for free like that. His arrangements, royalty possibilities, and, you know, advantage that he did not have simply for the fact of being Anna Gordy Gaye's husband at Motown. So he's an artist, though, right? And I think he's definitely engaging in that skill facet of him actualizing himself throughout that decade, such that by the time that that decade goes by, that's enough time and hours of experience underneath one's belt. He is at a level of expertise. Okay. And now Tammy has passed away and he's very just kind of dejected. And I think that, you know, that's like a come to Jesus place in life. What did I say that I've recorded so many versions of this, but didn't I say, like, definitely for myself at the time of being in this decade, your mind just, it's add to it, like a global pandemic thing that's going on. This is what my dad and I were talking about the other day. I'm just going to say this and I'm going to keep moving. But in regard to a national election that just took place in this country, here's what I was knowing. Is that if the results would have gone a certain way and a certain thing would have just been continuing on for the next 4 years, strapped in, knew it, was the sign I needed, fuck for real, all the way out, this planet is now in the times of revelations. Strap up, get ready, keep dealing. But don't kid yourself, and no. And so, you know what I'm saying? When your now existence is just in a set of circumstances, you got to start getting ready, right? And getting aligned, and some type of soul satisfaction needs to be present and being revealed and being actualized in your life, okay? And so I think that just in all of Marvin Gaye's life, where he is at the point that he's now with his art beginning to create What's Going On, he's just had a real come to Jesus understanding
of like more important things that he's trying to accomplish and achieve with this thing, the art thing. And it ain't 3 minute long studio assembly line created, other people written and produced, sounding of a organization tracks. More soul satisfaction is needed. And that's what he's working on. To the degree that a draft of a single song has been created to be presented to Gordy for Gordy to arbitrarily, and just because he can, say no, he's not going to release. But let's look at what we now know. How many fucking times has Marvin been done this way by that point? It's too much. It's the straw that breaks his back. He's not playing these games anymore. And this is what goes down, people. Like, this is how I'm telling you he comes out swinging, because what does Gordy know about Marvin Gaye? Looking at his roster, he is the single most consistent, according to Gordy. That's where I'm getting the statistic from. Okay? So that was it. This is it. And, you know, everybody has a limit. And I promise you, you get past that limit, you're coming out swinging. It's the next thing that happens. So Marvin was done. He wasn't playing this game anymore. That's fine. Don't release this shit. Don't release it. Because somebody else is going to. Try me. And it seems like it has to be the time in this decade of this kind of bullshit going on between these two that Gordy did not roll those dice. So altogether, I don't know how much of Marvin's project has been conceptualized and visualized and, you know, clairaudient-ized, you know what I'm saying? Because he explains how he feels that he's just a vessel for God, that this music is being filtered through. So I don't know if all 9 songs are laid out and titled, and by the time that this draft of what's going on is being presented to Gordy to fuck with. You know, but once that battle is won for Marvin, that try it and think hard. Maybe you might want to take a second to think, try it, and then contemplate what the lack of further material from me, period, is all about. I'll give you a minute or so. Okay, so then once it's like, well, okay, better not, and now this is gonna happen, Gordy gives Marvin a month. According to one article that I have come across in this time, but oh, that's the article that I just had to be like, what the fuck? That was a piece of shit article. That was a little protege of Rit. I can guarantee you. See, that's where you gotta kind of just monitor and check shit. Because you leave shit unchecked, it's just disgusting to me. Oh, the trusted biographer of Marvin Gaye, David Rett. You know, they want to give their little YouTube video, book report, or whatever on Marvin. And then they, basically, the information that they're gonna be regurgitating to you is coming from the trusted Marvin Gaye biographer. Yeah. And so, see, a motherfucker like that takes an approach, and then it feels like it's accepted to be emulated. So there is an additional, I have no idea, it's a one-time young little punk got assigned to write his little article on the whole entire album project, what's going on. And there was a lot of in-depth information that was given, including the little statistic that now once this project is moving forward with Gordy's okay, he tries to insert and assert himself, you know, in his role of dominance, to only allow Marvin 30 days to get it all recorded. Okay. So that's why I know that if it's released in May of 71, but it took 30 days to get recorded. And what we also know is that wrapping that up has to be done being recorded for the most part. Marvin is leaving Detroit from having been in Studio A doing the recording, leaving Detroit, heading out to California to begin filming Chrome and Hot Leather. Now, what he does, I love Marvin Gaye, okay? What Marvin Gaye does, and he knows he has to do it, because this is the dawning of the age of Marvin Gaye's art representing two words, Marvin Gaye. Let me refresh you where we are in this point in time. If I had been alive, all right, since the beginning, since the Soulful Moods of Marvin Gaye, by this time, and I don't even know that this shit is happening yet, right? Because I'm not an insider in the industry and I don't know that this is about to be released. But anyway, by that point in time, I'm fan number one. Marvin Gaye is the baddest motherfucker that there ever is, because that's simply on the strength of the thing. Okay? So that's already been established. And now we're at this precipice where, additionally, for me as a fan, oh my gosh, the... Okay, I was about to say the manna, is it manna or mana from heaven, right? I'm about to be receiving. But just for like soul sustenance, just, you know, nourishment. Is going to now evolve into actually receiving the artwork of Marvin Gaye, okay? That's the point. It's now about to become the artwork of Marvin Gaye. In order to ensure that, Marvin knew where he was working without an advantage, and he had to travel across the country out of the location where this organization is located. And to ensure that the artwork that you and I were going to receive in May of 71 would completely be Marvin Gaye, this had to steal, air quotes, his masters out to LA with him to ensure that these motherfuckers weren't going to be impatient and the deadline has been set and we need to keep it moving and you're done now because we say so. So you got to take your hands off of this shit and we're going to splice it and dice it as we see fit to get it produced, like into actual physical form. And he wasn't done with it. But he had to take this trip out to LA too. So guess what's already being established and set up out in LA? Well, these are trying to move out there permanently. So they have studios out there too. So he takes it with him to ensure that it's not going to be done that way. And we know that what he continues to be working on, it's not just for playing games. He was not fucking done. But they needed him to be. He takes it out there, and what does he do? Marvin Gaye plays the, what is it, a Mellotron or something like that. It's some new state-of-the-art instrument that had just been created. And he plays it at the end of Mercy, Mercy Me, that do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do. That's like the finishing touch that he's artistically neat. He's his canvas. It's mostly there and you're an artist. And so the finishing touches, right? He was putting finishing touches. He needed those finishing touches to be inserted in the locations that he wanted it to be. Had he not taken his masters with him, they were going to take what he had already only made and release it as that. We know that they did that later, didn't they? So, you know, he knew where he was. And evidently, according to Gladys Knight, you know, he knew where he had just come back from being banished. I don't know why that lady was like, and he was going through hell. It's like, what the fuck are you bitches talking about? Like, I don't even know what they're talking about how Marvin had been banished over into Europe, like, right before this time frame that we're talking about. And God doesn't like ugly either, according to Gladys Knight. So it's like, what is going on? But Marvin knew. And he knew where he was, and he knew the games, and he knew... That's why I just love Marvin Gaye, people. I love his spirit. I love how he would not be dominated. I love how he did what he had to do. And honestly, Marvin Gaye opened up creative license and freedom and an almost approach. He didn't quite get it established for himself to appreciate all of the freedom... Maxwell, you're welcome. That you can take a decade in between your fucking projects. You can thank Marvin Gaye for that. And you have an ability to appreciate a freedom with your art that this man never got close to being able to likewise experience. But the reason why things in this industry are the way that they are now is for these trials and tribulations that artists, but really it's Marvin right here putting this on his shoulders to just kind of, and again, you know, it's his life, it's his struggle and it's his story, but this really does have some industry-wide consequences of some changes that are being made. It changes Motown. Stevie Wonder, you're welcome. Okay? So, he knew where he was, and he knew the game. He ain't playing, and he was not playing games. So, yeah. If you want to go ahead and label it as stealing your own shit, that's what he had to do to take it with him out to LA so that he could be able to put those finishing elements of Sazon on this shed. You know what I'm saying? It's the seasoning. It's the intricate detail. That is, what have we also learned about Marvin Gaye? His shit, people, it's about the intricate details. Okay? That's what sets him apart. That's what sets him apart. You gotta listen hard. Get your beats. Because you're gonna hear things that you don't ever hear until you hear it. And then usually when you're hearing that, it's him playing it. Did you know? So, yeah, this is beginning to happen. This is the first time, thank you, Marvin, for me, the sustenance that this all is, that he was ensuring that we were going to receive it at this level by doing what he had to do. So he steals it out there with him out to LA and he finishes it up. Okay. And then he turns it in, and now we get what's going on. A lot of songs are worked on during that time frame. You know what? A lot of songs being created in the course of a Marvin Gaye project. Wow. Well, that's like what happens. Fuck you, David Ritz. Wanting to try and talk shit about how only 8 songs get released. Well, it's like, that's par for the course. That's still an LP, motherfucker. You know what I'm saying? And how dare you, right, try and present that information like that because you don't do your own fucking research or you were fucking there. You didn't know. You couldn't ask. 48 tracks were a part of Midnight Love in the 40th anniversary release of What's Going On in YouTube, just in YouTube. It is a 46 song playlist just to listen to them from start to finish. I don't even fucking know if YouTube in this little playlist that I'm listening to has all of it. Let me switch over to Spotify really quick and let's just get that. So yeah, we get 9 songs on a vinyl, but a lot of music was being created at that point in time. The floodgates are open. in 71, how my life would have changed is that I'm already writing for Marvin and I already know. I already know what I'm telling you in 2021 now, right? Okay? I already know all that shit. But what gets to happen is that in 71, Yes, it is 46 because now I just got into Spotify. What's going on? 40th anniversary, super duper, triple dipple, double deluxe, 46 tracks. That's what he's working on. Jeez, Ritz, that's even two less tracks than Midnight Lady, bitch. Midnight Lady, I don't know why I can't get it right. Sexual Healing, Midnight Love. But how dare you? You know what I'm saying? Ritz, how dare you? When you had the lock to do the 12 pages of ass wipe write-up on the Midnight Love project, failed to point out that 48 tracks had been what was created, eight of which got finalized and presented, but you don't even have knowledge to know that that's even two more tracks, bitch, than what's going on, which is the only thing that you're trying to tout. Fuck you. You know what I'm saying? That's what people, please. Okay? So any fucking way, part of this work for what's going on in 71, May-ish, right? But that's what we know. Like, let me back out because this is what I was trying to establish. We know that it's not May-ish and it's not April-ish. And it's probably not even when a draft of Simply the Song. I do believe that that is what happened, is that it was a draft of Simply the Song, What's Going On, that Marvin presented to Gordy, that Gordy, just because he wanted to play games, said no, he's not releasing. Why? Because it's a little too political and he's really trying to make all of these inroads into white middle America, and that's a little scary, right? A little militant, little fuck the man. But is it really even? Come on, people. No, it's not even. There's trigger happy policing is about the calling the man on his shit that happens on that project. Flat out. You know what I'm saying? The little bit maybe were Marvin and I kicking it. You know what I'm saying? Because Marvin ain't even coming at nobody the way that I do. All right. So a threat and a fucking up your company's vision. Yeah. Get your life together again. And why? I'm saying I don't know that I trust my man's ear too well. So a part of the work that is going on during that opening of the floodgates of Marvin Gaye beginning to create his art, and he's going to reveal to you and I purely his art, is he's already, the juices are flowing, the creativity, the inspiration, the changing the game of the sound of music until the year 2021 and beyond. Yeah, stay tuned. Is what's happening in his mind and spirit and soul, and hear him express his experience of creating that sound. It was flowing through him from the divine, from God. He was a vessel. He didn't even feel like he was making that music. He's starting to hear the sound of what we receive with Trouble Man. Here, let me think now. I think I'm good. We've explained the backstory. Let me think. Is there anything else I've missed? Because I'm very glad that I started out with what's going on. Many months back, I remembered that I needed to start with what's going on. But then, you know, time goes on and you forget. And at a certain point, just a couple of weeks ago, I was like, oh, I had recorded some of this. And then I remembered, oh, fuck, I forgot. Marvin Gaye is already working on Trouble Man and on What's Going On. Let me listen to that song. Let me find that song. I know there is a song. I had to remind myself. I was like, wait, I know there's a song on What's Going On, the Sessions, that is Trouble Man, what it morphs into. And in my mind's eye right now, I'm seeing the section of the movie where Marvin's music is popping off, giving life to how, at that point in time, you were understanding a lot of Trouble Man's backstory has not been given to us because this is a Green Beret, Navy SEAL. You know, he's doing everything. And Marvin's music is just really giving that to you. And so I got into YouTube and I looked up and I knew I had to look for the 40th anniversary of What's Going On. And then I saw this 46 track playlist and I'm like, fuck, I don't remember what that song is called. And I don't own this hard copy, so I have not as in-depthly studied it as every hard copy purchase of Marvin Gaye's music that I do get. So I was like, fuck, I know it's on here somewhere, though. I know I've heard this. And I was flipping and flipping. It's towards the end, flipping, flipping, flipping through, and then there you get to it. And what it is just literally this slow motion. So as I told you, there's going to be sound in this. Let's do it. Okay? Because I don't need to tell you this. Let's hear it. Let's hear it. This is fair use. So we are going to hear music throughout this episode. Okay, T stands for time. Ready?
T stands for time. Or checking out. Take us one.
Okay, so, yeah, again, I'm thinking backstory, right? Getting us to Trouble Man. Yeah, I'm pretty sure we've just discussed it, right? Like, it's about Marvin Gaye's career. It's about the floodgates opening of his art. It's about, let's segue into an uninformed, unintelligent music writer that wants to. So let me explain to you what you have heard in a musical critique type of way in regard to the project Trouble Man, being the fact that it follows what's going on. There's confusion, right? Musical critics, they're confused. They don't understand, like, how could Marvin Gaye follow up what's going on with Trouble Man? What it does, what's the... Well, he began working on music for that project in the process of the floodgates of creativity and inspiration opening up on his project, What's Going On, Bitch. Come on, people. I'm going to need you to be able to keep the fuck up. Otherwise, shut the fuck up. Do you know what I'm saying? Like, how fucking dare that on this planet that somebody that has some shit to say, you know, because they've been assigned to say some shit and they don't know what the fuck they're talking about. But that's what you have to have access to understand things and get a preconceived notion about what the fuck only the quality of something is, or, you know, only where something came from and how something doesn't make sense to be the next thing following something. And it's just like, stop. And in that case, shut the fuck up. You know what I mean? Did I say it in this episode? Because like I said, I've been recording this trying to get the thoughts right. But it is amazing to me, because let's look at where we are. This is being recorded in March to April, right? Time frame of 71. Because he's got 30 days to record this shit. So that we just heard, he was in Studio A recording that. And that was him most definitely playing the little keyboard organ sounding thing that we heard going on, right? Because we know that he played all the piano on What's Going On. So he's working on that fucking project. That was him, you know? And the name of that song is T Stands for Time. Well, how? Why is that already called? I don't know if I've said this in this episode. And if I did, I'm going to say it again because it's perfectly where we need to say it. Why was that already called? Hold on. I hate being in Spotify because the controls. Okay. T stands for time. That's what the man said. T stands for time, or checking out the take is one. Now, hold on. There is another song also included in this 40th anniversary that's called Checking Out Double Clutch, but that sounds different. And I feel like actually Checking Out Double Clutch, I received in the Marvin Gaye, the Master thing that came out when I was 16, I do believe. And I'm going to just tell you this because I'm so... about that project. I thought it was over here. Where the fuck is that now? Oh my goodness. The lack of respect sometimes that I am showing for my material. Here it is. It was actually right where I was. And I don't think I've ever pointed this out to you, and I'm just going to leave it at this. On Marvin Gaye, Master. Marvin loves my birthday. He spoils me on my birthday. I do believe I was 16 when I got this. This is so special. It's probably the most special. I don't know. I'm receiving new material to this day. But I believe I was 16 when I got this. Let me see here. Is there a release year? Yeah, 1995. I was 16. So beautiful and so special. When I got this package, and hold on, I was looking to see about Double Clutch, right? Hold on 1 second here. There's a disc 3, which contains a lot of the What's Going On project. And so, let me see. Piece of Clay, You're the Man. Okay, Checking Out Double Clutch, okay? So you got Checking Out Double Clutch in 95. I did. And so I'd already heard that. That's not the same thing that we just listened to that morphed into Trouble Man. But I have it right here in my hat. In this project, there is a song that had been unreleased by Marvin Gaye. And it's so beautiful. And he recorded it on my birthday. Oh. That's why I said, like, Marvin loves my birthday. Yeah. So, and it's such a beautiful song, but I'm going to leave it at that. Okay. So, yeah, we're good on the backstory now. We're good on the backstory. So stay tuned. I don't know if I'm just going to release this all at once or if we just take a little time and we get this far and then we continue on. But from here, we just keep it moving. We're just going right in sequence the very next thing that happens. And that is exactly what happened. Anybody that doesn't understand how Trouble Man follows what's going on, the floodgates have opened. And what's going on is our first presentation of complete two words, Marvin Gaye. Okay. And from that point forward for the rest of his career, that's what we receive. And when that level of like a flood of art, and really coming from when you yourself as the creator of that view yourself as just a vessel for what's going on, that is like inspiration on a supernatural level. I was listening to some stuff lately, and you know, it was like on a topic of something, you know, that could be considered like a challenge in life, but that was exactly the same type of thing. It was like, don't you kind of understand like how you are dealing with something that is supernatural? It's like beyond your capacities to deal with or handle, and how like it's supernatural. Therefore, like the level of assistance that you need with that exactly that can apply with sometimes the level of struggle that you could be dealing with in life, or the level of creativity and inspiration that you are being used as a vessel for, to create for the planet, for infinity. You know what I mean? And so when something has that ability to be relevant for infinity, well, yeah, it probably came from a supernatural source, like those two. Yeah. And that's what the fuck was going on here. So, but that floodgate had opened and it just continued from there. Here will be a very important thing. I'm going to find where Marvin Gaye himself speaks to his project's Trouble Man. And he completely, correctly, obviously, the single most important reference that you should be seeking out to get an understanding of what the fuck does Marvin Gaye's music mean and why did this happen and what's that about? Could you do a little bit of research to see if Marvin Gaye himself ever spoke on that? And he does. And he speaks on Trouble Man. And he speaks on kind of how people have slept on it within his own lifetime. But then he also explains, like, bitches, exactly why the fuck you're sleeping on it if you don't fucking get it. So yeah, stay tuned. But let me just, like, really tease ya with what the fuck we're going to be further learning about, which will continue to be my explanation for fair use and why you will be continuing to hear music, because I'm educating the fuck out of y'all motherfuckers right now, okay? And you gotta hear it to really get it. I can't make any money off of this. I have no sponsorship. I don't have no ad revenue. There's no money on my part to be made, so everybody can hear this shit, okay? But yeah, I said it a few minutes back how Marvin Gaye, kind of through this time frame right now that we're talking about, the 71 to 7, continuing on to 72, this music that he is making is changing the game of the sound of music real hardcore, continuing up through this time frame that you and I are breathing the air in and out of. Okay? Up through 2021, and it will continue to be beyond. And that shit is originating with these projects. So yeah, stay tuned. And we'll go from there. Oh shit. My recorder like cut me off because I was getting right at an hour. So it just cut me off. But
Thank you guys for listening. I just have edited this whole episode. And it's hilarious. I love it. It's good times. So yeah, I'm going to release just this much. And let's absorb it. Let's marinate. Let me guide you to my channel. And I'll move this up and make it a little bit more prominent. I'm going to make available easily for you the movie Trouble Man. Watch the movie. Kick back, pop some popcorn, and enjoy the movie. It's not a bad movie. It's really not a bad movie. There are some talented actors in the movie. You've got Paul Winfield, who in the exact same year films the movie Sounder, which is featured on my classic movie channel if you would like to watch that. Great classic African-American culture film. You need to watch that. Please do. And it's available for free, commercial free, on my Cinema Classics YouTube channel. Check it out. But he's like one of the stars in that movie. You have, I've seriously, like, I don't know, but like, I never did watch this show, but I know he's from that show. The Waltons. Good night, John Boy. Good night. They take like 12 minutes to like say goodnight to everybody in this family of like 45 people living in the house or whatever. But that show, I feel like it's the dad from The Waltons is like a really bad character in this movie. And then there's this other guy who you've seen, other older white dude. He's the police officer. You've seen him in other prominent movies before too. So I'd never seen Trouble Man like before or since as an actor, but he's good too. The lady Cleo, his love interest, you see her in other movies too. So I'm just trying to think anybody else kind of name brand actor wise, but it is a good enough movie for like, you can seriously take a gander at the movie Trouble Man and just enjoy it. It is such an adorable little vehicle. It really is. Now when we get to our use for the movie, it is an absolutely adorable vehicle for simply communicating the sound of Marvin's music, right? Once you really check it out for that, I would appreciate if before the rest of this episode-ishness that I will be recording, I'm going to take a break for right now and I'll get to the rest of it later. But if you will have taken a look at that movie to be able to appreciate all of the sound of music in that movie and just, it, like I said, it then kind of translate the purpose of that movie, translates the purpose of that movie into being this adorable little vehicle simply for exposing yourself to all of the music that Marvin made for that movie. It's adorable. When you do it like that, when you watch Trouble Man just to hear Marvin Gaye's music in that movie, it like changes the experience for you. You're paying a lot the fuck more attention and you're maybe even pausing and rewinding. And if you did like me, you're like pausing and you're like, okay, I just heard that music. Do this game, even do this game. Then it's like, what song was that right now from Trouble Man, which I've had for 25 years, and boom, 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 like that. How come I don't just know the name of the tracks? Do that game. That's a fun little game to play, to listen to the movie, hear a song, pause it, turn on Trouble Man, the album, and what song did you just hear? That was really interesting. That was very, if you're like me and you've smoked a lot of weed over a lot of years, and so you need to kind of strengthen memory muscles and shred, that's a little exercise that you can do. It was a mind exercise. It was fun. I enjoyed that challenge. Let's just view the movie. Like I said, I'll make it more prominent, easy to get to on the YouTube channel. Listen to the music. Listen to your just original 1972 released project, and then definitely get into the 40th anniversary. School yourself. Listen, and then be ready for our next assignment, which is just the perfect going out on top
You will have no questions in your mind for the rest of your life. I promise you. For the reason why. We know that Marvin Gaye is the baddest motherfucker. That it ever there is to be concepted when it comes to the topic of music. Okay? I promise you. So stay tuned. I'll talk to you soon. Love you guys. Bye-bye.
Well, friends, that's it for this episode. Did we have fun? I had fun. Subscribe to our show so you never miss the enduring gifts of Marvin Gaye. Follow us on Pinterest, pinterest.com/MarvinGaye_enduring_gifts. There, we are up to 45,000 views per month. I have thousands of images and videos of Marvin. Also, check out the YouTube channel, Marvin Gaye's Enduring Gifts. I'm building the Song of the Day playlist there. It's my ultimate goal to become your free online Marvin Gaye listening resource. So, as always, we really appreciate your listening support. Give us subscribes, give us likes, and thank you for listening.